This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Manet Machine. Author, Julien Offray de La Mettrie. Year, 1912. Preface. The French text presented in this volume is taken from that of a Leyden edition of 1748, in other words, from that of an edition published in the year and in the place of issue of the first edition. The title page of this edition is reproduced in the present volume. The original was evidently the work of a Dutch compositor unschooled in the French language, and is full of imperfections, inconsistencies, and grammatical blunders. By the direction of the publishers, these obviously typographical blunders have been corrected by M. Lucien Arréat of Paris. The translation is the work of several hands. It is founded on a version made by Miss Gertrude C. Bussy from the French text in the edition of J. Assezet, and has been revised by Professor M. W. Calkins, who is responsible for it in its present form. Mademoiselle M. Corrette, of the Wellesley College Department of French, and Professor George Santayana of Harvard University have given valued assistance, and this opportunity is taken to acknowledge their kindness in solving the problems of interpretation which have been submitted to them. It should be added that the translation sometimes subordinates the claims of English structure and style in the effort to render La Mettrie's meaning exactly. The paragraphing of the French is usually followed, but the italics and the capitals are not reproduced. The page headings of the translation refer back to the pages of the French text, and a few words inserted by the translators are enclosed in brackets. The philosophical and historical notes are condensed and adapted from a master's thesis on La Mettrie, presented by Miss Buzzy to the faculty of Wellesley College. Topic: Frederick the Great's Eulogy on Julien Offray de La Mettrie. Julien Offray de La Mettrie was born in Saint-Malo on the 25th of December, 1709, to Julien Offray de La Mettrie and Marie Gaudron, who were living by a trade large enough to provide a good education for their son. They sent him to the College of Coutances to study the humanities. He went from there to Paris, to the College of Plessis. He studied his rhetoric at Caen, and since he had much genius and imagination, he won all the prizes for eloquence. He was a born orator, and was passionately fond of poetry and belles lettres, but his father thought that he would earn more as an ecclesiastic than as a poet, and destined him for the church. He sent him the following year to the College of Plessis, where he studied logic under M. Cordier, who was more a Jansenist than a logician. It is characteristic of an ardent imagination to seize forcefully the objects presented to it, as it is characteristic of youth to be prejudiced in favor of the first opinions that are inculcated. Any other scholar would have adopted the opinions of his teacher, but that was not enough for young La Mettrie. He became a Jansenist and wrote a work which had great vogue in that party. In 1725, he studied natural philosophy at the College of Harcourt and made great progress there. On his return to Brittany, M. Huneau, a doctor of Saint-Malo, had advised him to adopt the medical profession. They had persuaded his father, assuring him that a mediocre physician would be better paid for his remedies than a good priest for absolutions. At first, young La Mettrie had applied himself to the study of anatomy. For 2 years he had worked at the dissecting table. After this, in 1725, he took the degree of doctor at Reims and was there received as a physician. In 1733, he went to Leyden to study under the famous Boerhaave. The master was worthy of the scholar, and the scholar soon made himself worthy of the master. M. La Mettrie devoted all the acuteness of his mind to the knowledge and to the healing of human infirmities, and he soon became a great physician. In the year 1734, during his leisure moments, he translated a treatise of the late M. Boerhaave, his Aphrodisiacus, and joined to it a dissertation on venereal maladies of which he himself was the author. The old physicians in France rose up against a scholar who affronted them by knowing as much as they. One of the most celebrated doctors of Paris, did him the honor of criticizing his work, a sure proof that it was good. Lemaitre replied, and to confound his adversary still more, he composed in 1736 a treatise on vertigo, esteemed by all impartial physicians. By an unfortunate effect of human imperfection, a certain base jealousy has come to be one of the characteristics of men of letters. This feeling incites those who have reputations to oppose the progress of budding geniuses. This blight often fastens on talents without destroying them, but it sometimes injures them. M. Lemaitre, who was advancing in the career of science at a giant's pace, suffered from this jealousy, and his quick temper made him too susceptible to it. In St. Malo, he translated the aphorisms of Boerhaave, the Materia Medica, the Chemical Proceedings, the Chemical Theory, and the Institutions by this same author. About the same time, he published an abstract of Sydenham. The young doctor had learned by premature experience that if he wished to live in peace, it was better to translate than to compose, but it is characteristic of genius to escape from reflection. Counting on himself alone, if I may speak thus, and filled with the knowledge he had gained from his infinitely skillful researches into nature, he wished to communicate to the public the useful discoveries he had made. He published his treatise on smallpox, his practical medicine, and 6 volumes of commentary on the physiology of Boerhaave. All these works appeared at Paris, although the author had written them at St. Malo. He joined to the theory of his art an always successful practice, which is no small recommendation for a physician. In 1742, Lemaitre came to Paris, led there by the death of M. Huneau, his old teacher. Morand and Sidobert introduced him to the Duke of Gramont, who, a few days after, obtained for him the commission of Physician of the Guards. He accompanied the Duke to war, and was with him at the Battle of Dettingen, at the Siege of Freiburg, and at the Battle of Fontenoy, where he lost his patron, who was killed by a cannon shot. Lemaitre felt this loss all the more keenly, because it was at the same time the reef on which his fortune was wrecked. This is what happened. During the campaign of Freiburg, Lemaitre had an attack of violent fever. For a philosopher, an illness is a school of physiology. He believed that he could clearly see that thought is but a consequence of the organization of the machine, and that the disturbance of the springs has considerable influence on that part of us which the metaphysicians call soul. Filled with these ideas during his convalescence, he boldly bore the torch of experience into the night of metaphysics. He tried to explain by the aid of anatomy the thin texture of understanding, and he found only mechanism where others had supposed an essence superior to matter. He had his philosophic conjectures printed under the title of The Natural History of the Soul. The chaplain of the regiment sounded the tocsin against him, and at first sight all the devotees cried out against him. The common ecclesiastic is like Don Quixote, who found marvelous adventures in commonplace events, or like the famous soldier, so engrossed with his system that he found columns in all the books he read. The majority of priests examine all works of literature as if they were treatises on theology, and filled with this one aim, they discover heresies everywhere. To this fact are due very many false judgments, and very many accusations, for the most part unfair, against the authors. A book of physics should be read in the spirit of a physicist. Nature, the truth, is its sole judge, and should absolve or condemn it. A book of astronomy should be read in the same manner. If a poor physician proves that the blow of a stick smartly rapped on the skull disturbs the mind, or that at a certain degree of heat reason wanders, one must either prove the contrary or keep quiet. If a skillful astronomer proves, in spite of Joshua, that the earth and all the celestial globes revolve around the sun, one must either calculate better than he, or admit that the earth revolves. But the theologians, who by their continual apprehension might make the weak believe that their cause is bad, are not troubled by such a small matter. They insisted on finding seeds of heresy in a work dealing with physics. The author underwent a frightful persecution, and the priests claimed that a doctor accused of heresy could not cure the French guards. To the hatred of the devotees was joined that of his rivals for glory. This was rekindled by a work of Lemaître's entitled The Politics of Physicians. A man full of cunning and carried away by ambition aspired to the place then vacant of first physician to the King of France. He thought that he could gain it by heaping ridicule upon those of his contemporaries who might lay claim to this position. He wrote a libel against them, and abusing the easy friendship of Lemaître, he enticed him to lend to it the volubility of his pen and the richness of his imagination. Nothing more was needed to complete the downfall of a man little known, against whom were all appearances, and whose only protection was his merit. For having been too sincere as a philosopher and too obliging as a friend, Lemaître was compelled to leave his country. The Duke of Duras and the Viscount of Chila advised him to flee from the hatred of the priests and the revenge of the physicians. Therefore, in 1746, he left the hospitals of the army where he had been placed by M. Seychelles, and came to Leyden to philosophize in peace. He there composed his Penelope, a polemical work against the physicians in which, after the fashion of Democritus, he made fun of the vanity of his profession. The curious result was that the doctors themselves, though their quackery was painted in true colors, could not help laughing when they read it, and that is a sure sign that they had found more wit than malice in it. M. Lemaître, after losing sight of his hospitals and his patients, gave himself up completely to speculative philosophy. He wrote his Man a Machine, or rather, he put on paper some vigorous thoughts about materialism, which he doubtless planned to rewrite. This work, which was bound to displease men who by their position are declared enemies of the progress of human reason, roused all the priests of Leyden against its author. Calvinists, Catholics, and Lutherans forgot for the time that consubstantiation, free will, mass for the dead, and the infallibility of the Pope divided them. They all united again to persecute a philosopher who had the additional misfortune of being French, at a time when that monarchy was waging a successful war against their high powers. The title of philosopher and the reputation of being unfortunate were enough to procure for Lemaître a refuge in Prussia with a pension from the king. He came to Berlin in the month of February in the year 1748. He was there received as a member of the Royal Academy of Science. Medicine reclaimed him from metaphysics, and he wrote a treatise on dysentery, another on asthma, the best that had then been written on these cruel diseases. He sketched works on certain philosophical subjects which he had proposed to look into. By a sequence of accidents which befell him, these works were stolen, but he demanded their suppression as soon as they appeared. Lemaître died in the house of Milord Tyrconnel, minister plenipotentiary of France, whose life he had saved. It seems that the disease, knowing with whom it had to deal, was clever enough to attack his brain first, so that it would more surely confound him. He had a burning fever, and was violently delirious. The invalid was obliged to depend upon the science of his colleagues, and he did not find there the resources which he had so often found in his own, both for himself and for the public. He died on the 11th of November, 1751, at the age of 43 years. He had married Louise Charlotte Drayano, by whom he left only a daughter, 5 years and a few months old. Lemaître was born with a fund of natural and inexhaustible gaiety. He had a quick mind, and such a fertile imagination, that it made flowers grow in the field of medicine. Nature had made him an orator and a philosopher, but a yet more precious gift which he received from her was a pure soul and an obliging heart. All those who are not imposed upon by the pious insults of the theologians mourn in Lemaître a good man and a wise physician. Topic: L'homme machine. Man a machine. Il ne suffit pas à un sage d'étudier la nature et la vérité. Il doit aussi le dire en faveur du petit nombre de ceux qui veulent et peuvent penser, car pour les autres, qui sont volontairement esclaves des préjugés, il ne leur est pas plus possible d'étendre la vérité, qu'aux grenouilles de voleur. It is not enough for a wise man to study nature and truth. He should dare state truth for the benefit of the few who are willing and able to think. As for the rest, who are voluntarily slaves of prejudice, they can no more attain truth than frogs can fly. Je réduis à deux les systèmes des philosophies sur le mais de l'homme. Le premier est le plus ancien, est le système du matérialisme, le second est celui du spiritualisme. I reduce to two the systems of philosophy which deal with man's soul. The first and older system is materialism. The second is spiritualism. Les métaphysiciens qui ont insinué que la matière pourrait bien avoir la faculté de penser, en ont pas déshonoré leur raison. Pourquoi? C'est qu'ils ont cet avantage, car ils est un de cetera mal exprimés. En effet, demander si la matière peut penser, sans la considérer autrement qu'en elle-même, c'est demander si la matière peut marquer les hers. En voit d'avance que nous éviterons cet écueil, au Mr. Locke et eu le malheur d'écouer. The metaphysicians, who have hinted that matter may well be endowed with the faculty of thought one, have perhaps not reasoned ill. For there is in this case a certain advantage in their inadequate way of expressing their meaning. In truth, to ask whether matter can think, without considering it otherwise than in itself, is like asking whether matter can tell time. It may be foreseen that we shall avoid this reef upon which Locke had the bad luck to make shipwreck. Les Leibnizians, avec leurs monades, ont élevé une hypothèse inintelligible. Ils ont plutôt spiritualisé la matière, que matérialisé la mais. Comment peut on définir un être dont la nature nous est absolument inconnue? The Leibnizians, with their monads, have set up an unintelligible hypothesis. They have rather spiritualized matter than materialized the soul. How can we define a being whose nature is absolutely unknown to us, too? Descartes et tous les Cartésiens, parmi lesquels il y a longtemps qu'on a compté les malabranchistes, ont fait la même faute. Ils ont admis deux substances distinctes dans l'homme, comme s'ils les avaient vues et bien comptées. Descartes and all the Cartesians, among whom the followers of Malebranche have long been numbered, have made the same mistake. They have taken for granted two distinct substances in man, as if they had seen them and positively counted them. Les plus sages ont dit que la main ne pouvait se connaître que par les seules lumières de la foi. Cependant, en qualité d'être raisonnable, ils ont cru pouvoir se réserver le droit d'examiner ce que l'écriture a voulu dire par le mot esprit, dont elle se sert en parlant de la main humaine, et dans leurs recherches, s'ils ne sont pas d'accord sur ce point avec les théologiens, ceci le sont ils d'avantage entre eux sur tous les autres? The wisest men have declared that the soul cannot know itself, save by the light of faith. However, as reasonable beings, they have thought that they could reserve for themselves the right of examining what the Bible means by the word spirit, which it uses in speaking of the human soul. And if in their investigation, they do not agree with the theologians on this point, are the theologians more in agreement among themselves on all other points? Voici en peu de mots le résultat de toutes leurs réflexions. S'il y a un Dieu, il est auteur de la nature. Comme de la révélation, il nous a donné l'une, pour expliquer l'autre et la raison, pour les accorder ensemble. C'est défier des connaissances qu'on peut puir dans les corps animés. C'est regarder la nature et la révélation comme deux contraires qui se détruisent, et par conséquent. C'est oser soutenir cette absurdité que Dieu se contredit dans ses divers ouvrages et nous trompe. Here's the result in a few words of all their reflections. If there is a God, he is the author of nature as well as of revelation. He has given us the one to explain the other, and reason to make them agree. To distrust the knowledge that can be drawn from the study of animated bodies is to regard nature and revelation as two contraries which destroy each the other, and consequently, to dare uphold the absurd doctrine that God contradicts himself in his various works and deceives us. S'il y a une révélation, elle ne peut donc démentir la nature. Par la nature seule, on peut découvrir le sens des paroles de l'Évangile, dont l'expérience seule est la véritable interpréta. En effet, les autres commentateurs jusqu'ici n'ont fait qu'embrouler la vérité. Nous allons en jugger par l'odeur du spectacle de la nature. Il est étonnant, dit il au sujet de Mr. Locke, qu'un homme qui dégrade notre âme jusqu'à la quara, un âme de bouée, ose établir la raison pour juge et souverain arbitre des mystères de la foi car, ajoute-t-il, quelle idée étonnante aurait en du christianisme si l'on voulait s'ouvrir la raison. If there is a revelation, it cannot then contradict nature. By nature only can we understand the meaning of the words of the gospel, of which experience is the only true interpreter. In fact, the commentators before our time have only obscured the truth. We can judge of this by the author of The Spectacle of Nature, 3. It is astonishing, he says concerning Locke, that a man who degrades our soul far enough to consider it a soul of clay should dare set up reason as judge and sovereign arbiter of the mysteries of faith, for, he adds, what an astonishing idea of Christianity one would have if one were to follow reason. Outre que ces réflexions n'éclaircissent rien par rapport à la foi, elles forment de ces frivoles objections contre la méthode de ceux qui croient pouvoir interpréter les livres saints, que j'ai presque hanté de perdre le temps à les refuter. Not only do these reflections fail to elucidate faith, but they also constitute such frivolous objections to the method of those who undertake to interpret the scripture, that I am almost ashamed to waste time in refuting them. 1. L'excellence de la raison ne dépend pas d'un grand mot vide de sens, la matérialité, mais de sa force, de son étendue, ou de sa clairvoyance. Ainsi un aim de bouée, qui découvrirait, comme d'un coup d'œil, les rapports et les suites d'une infinité d'idées difficiles à saisir, serait évidemment préalable à un aim sot et stupide qui serait fait des éléments les plus précieux. Si n'est pas être philosophie, que de rougir avec plein de la misère de notre origine. Si qui pourrait vil, est ici la chose la plus précieuse, et pour laquelle la nature semble avoir mis la plus d'art et la plus d'apparel. Mais comme l'homme, quand même il viendrait d'une source encore plus vile en apparence, et n'en serait pas moins la plus parfaite de tous les êtres, quel que soit l'origine de son aim, si elle est pure, noble, sublime, c'est une belle aim, qui rend respectable quiconque en est doué. The excellence of reason does not depend on a big word devoid of meaning, immateriality, but on the force, extent, and perspicuity of reason itself. Thus a soul of clay, which should discover at one glance, as it were, the relations and the consequences of an infinite number of ideas hard to understand, would evidently be preferable to a foolish and stupid soul, though that were composed of the most precious elements. A man is not a philosopher, because, with Pliny, he blushes over the wretchedness of our origin. What seems vile is here the most precious of things, and seems to be the object of nature's highest art and most elaborate care. But as man, even though he should come from an apparently still more lowly source, would yet be the most perfect of all beings, so whatever the origin of his soul, if it is pure, noble, and lofty, it is a beautiful soul which dignifies the man endowed with it. La seconde manière de raisonner de Mr. Plachy me pourrait visus, meme dans son système, qui tient un peu du fanatisme, car si nous avons une idée de la foi, qui soit contraire aux principes les plus clairs, aux vérités les plus incontestables, il faut croire, pour l'honneur de la révélation et de son auteur, que cette idée est fausse, et que nous ne connaissons point encore les sens des paroles de l'Évangile. Plachy's second way of reasoning seems vicious to me, even in his system, which smacks a little of fanaticism. For on his view, if we have an idea of faith as being contrary to the clearest principles, to the most incontestable truths, we must yet conclude, out of respect for revelation and its author, that this conception is false, and that we do not yet understand the meaning of the words of the gospel. De Dieu choses l'une, ou tout est illusion. Tant la nature même que la révélation, ou l'expérience seule peut rendre raison de la foi. Mais quel plus grand ridicule que celui de notre auteur? Je m'imagine entendre un péripatéticien, qui dirait, il ne faut pas croire l'expérience de Torricelli, car si nous le croyons, si nous allions banner l'horreur du vide, quelle étonnante philosophie aurions-nous? Of the two alternatives, only one is possible. Either everything is illusion, nature as well as revelation, or experience alone can explain faith. But what can be more ridiculous than the position of our author? Can one imagine hearing a peripatetic say, "We ought not to accept the experiments of Torricelli, for if we should accept them, if we should rid ourselves of the horror of the void, what an astonishing philosophy we should have." J'ai fait voir combien le raisonnement de Mr. Plachy est visso. A fin de prover premièrement qu'il y a une révélation. Elle n'est point suffisamment démontrée par la seule autorité de l'Église et sans aucun examen de la raison, comme le prétendent tous ceux qui la craignent. Secondement, pour mettre à l'abri de toute attaque la méthode de ceux qui voudraient s'ouvrir la voie que je leur ouvre, d'interpréter les choses surnaturelles, incomprehensibles en soi, par les lumières que chacune a recuse de la nature. L'expérience et l'observation doivent donc seules nous guider ici. Elles se trouvent sans nombre dans les faces des médecins, qui ont été philosophies et non dans les philosophies, qui n'ont pas été médecins. Ceci ont parcouru, ont éclairé le labyrinthe de l'homme, ils nous ont seules dévoilé ces resorts cachés sous des enveloppes qui dérobent à nos yeux tant de merveilles. Vous seuls contemplant tranquillement notre âme, l'ont mille fois surprise, et dans sa misère et dans sa grandeur, sans plus le mépriser dans l'une de ses états que l'admirer dans l'autre. Encore une fois, voilà les seuls physiciens qui ont droit de parler ici. Que nous dire les autres, et surtout les théologiens? N'est-il pas ridicule de les entendre décider sans pudeur? Sur un sujet qu'ils n'ont point été à portée de connaître. Don't ils ont été au contraire entièrement déternés par des études obscures, qui les ont conduits à mille préjugés, et pour tout dire en un mot au fanatisme, qui ajoute encore à leur ignorance dans le mécanisme des corps. I have shown how vicious the reasoning of Plachy is, in order to prove in the first place, that if there is a revelation it is not sufficiently demonstrated by the mere authority of the Church, and without any appeal to reason, as all those who fear reason claim, and in the second place, to protect against all assault the method of those who would wish to follow the path that I open to them, of interpreting supernatural things, incomprehensible in themselves, in the light of those ideas with which nature has endowed us. Experience and observation should therefore be our only guides here. Both are to be found throughout the records of the physicians who were philosophers, and not in the works of the philosophers who were not physicians. The former have traveled through and illuminated the labyrinth of man. They alone have laid bare to us those springs of life, hidden under the external integument which conceals so many wonders from our eyes. They alone, tranquilly contemplating our soul, have surprised it 1,000 times both in its wretchedness and in its glory, and they have no more despised it in the first estate than they have admired it in the second. Thus, to repeat, only the physicians have a right to speak on this subject. 5. What could the others, especially the theologians, have to say? Is it not ridiculous to hear them shamelessly coming to conclusions about a subject concerning which they have had no means of knowing anything, and from which, on the contrary, they have been completely turned aside by obscure studies that have led them to 1,000 prejudiced opinions, in a word, to fanaticism, which adds yet more to their ignorance of the mechanism of the body? Mais quoique nous ayons choisi les meilleurs guides, nous trouverons encore beaucoup d'épines et d'obstacles dans cette carrière. But even though we have chosen the best guides, we shall still find many thorns and stumbling blocks in the way. L'homme est une machine si composée, qu'il est impossible de s'en faire debord une idée claire et conséquemment de la définir. C'est pourquoi toutes les recherches que les plus grandes philosophies ont fait a priori, c'est à dire en voulant se servir en quelque sorte des ailes de l'esprit, ont été vaines. And si ce n'est qu'à posteriori, ou en cherchant à démolir le mais comme au travers les organes du corps, qu'on peut, je ne dis pas découvrir avec évidence la nature même de l'homme, mais attendre le plus grand degré de probabilité possible sur ce sujet. Man is so complicated a machine 6 that it is impossible to get a clear idea of the machine beforehand, and hence impossible to define it. For this reason, all the investigations have been vain, which the greatest philosophers have made a priori. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.